Well, amen. Thank you so much. Thank you, Brandon, Sierra, choir, orchestra. We appreciate that. Great job. I invite you to open your Bibles with us once again today to the Gospel of Luke. We are preaching through Luke's Gospel, and today I want us to begin looking at chapter number 11, Luke's Gospel, chapter number 11. Now, let me tell you that over the next 3 weeks, we are going to be in the first 13 verses of Luke chapter 11. There at the beginning of this chapter are some of the most familiar verses that we find in the Scripture, and yet I believe that there is a lot for us to learn today that will be very helpful to us. Now, the reason I want to be in these 13 verses over these next 3 weeks is because these 13 verses deal with the same subject matter, and that is the subject of prayer. And so today I want to talk about Teach Us to Pray, Part 1. Teach Us to Pray, Part 1. Luke chapter number 11. Now, I really do believe that what we're going to see in these 13 verses, we're going to see some material that is absolutely vital for our success and our walk with Christ in this new year. I am grateful that these verses are coming up at the beginning of a new year, because here are some verses that will be vital and helpful in our success and our victory in our walk with Christ in 2022. Remember last week that we looked at the latter verses of chapter number 10. I believe it was by divine appointment that those verses came up as we were moving into a new year. And remember out of those verses that we said that our 2022 priority is to sit at the feet of Jesus, listening to Him. Well, I believe that these verses are on the same plane of priority for us in 2022, and that is sitting at the feet of Jesus and talking to Him. And in this year, if we will sit at the feet of Jesus and listen to Him and sit at the feet of Jesus and talk to Him, I'll guarantee you that we will prosper spiritually. So let's look at these verses, Luke chapter 11. Today we'll read the first four verses, although we will only look at the first two verses. Luke chapter 11, verse 1, the Bible says, "Now it came to pass that as He was praying in a certain place," that is Jesus, "when He ceased, that one of His disciples said to Him, 'Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples.' And so He said to them, 'When you pray, pray this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Your kingdom come, Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us day by day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we must also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one.'" Now, for almost 2,000 years, this particular prayer has been referred to as the Lord's Prayer. And I'm not about to change the name of that prayer today. Historically, that is what this prayer has been known as. But we all know that in reality, the best way to identify this prayer would be to refer to it as the disciples' prayer and not the Lord's Prayer. Now, we know that because Luke explicitly states in verse number 1, that is what it was. One of His disciples said to Him, "Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples." Now, we know that in reality, this could not be the Lord's Prayer. We know that Jesus did not pray this prayer. He could not have prayed this prayer, because down in verse number 4, He said that we are to pray, "Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who is indebted," or "who sins against us." And so here's a part of that prayer the Lord Jesus obviously never would have prayed. He could not have prayed that, because we know that Jesus was sinless. And so He could not pray, "Father, forgive me." And so this is in reality the disciples' prayer. It's teaching us how that we are to pray. really believe when we look at the prayer that the important thing that we could say about it is that it is in reality a structure for us in knowing how to pray. It involves the things that we ought to be aware of that ought to be included in our daily prayer lives. Kind of like, you know, an outline of prayer, although I would say that it's not necessarily an outline of praying that we are to just follow point by point. For example, I think about Simon Peter. Remember that time when Simon Peter got into a real problem when he was out walking on the water trying to get to Jesus? And remember that he just simply stopped and he prayed, "Lord, save me." Now, if Simon Peter would have treated this prayer like an outline, he'd have been in serious trouble. I mean, if Simon Peter would have been praying through this prayer and he said, "Now, wait a minute, before I say, Lord, save me, I've got to say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." By the time he got to, "Lord, save me," he'd have been blowing bubbles. So this is not at all an outline of prayer where we just legalistically, point by point, follow the outline, but it's more of a structure of prayer that alerts us to what ought to be involved in our prayer life on a daily basis when we come before the Lord. Something that really has always blessed me about this prayer is what it says about John the Baptist. These disciples of Jesus, they said, "Teach us to pray as John also taught his disciples to pray." Now, when you and I think about John the Baptist, what do we normally think of? We think about a guy that was a martyr. We think about a guy that was the forerunner to the Messiah. But it's so interesting that when the disciples of Jesus, when they thought about John the Baptist, first and foremost, they thought about him being a man of prayer. Now, that is absolutely fascinating to me. When we think about John the Baptist and think who he was. As a matter of fact, John the Baptist was a miracle baby. The Bible says that he was filled with the Holy Spirit of God while he was still in his mother's womb, and yet John was a man of prayer. The Bible says of John the Baptist that he was given the amazing privilege of announcing the Messiah to Israel, and yet John the Baptist had to depend upon prayer. Jesus said of John that no one has ever lived who is greater than John the Baptist. And yet John the Baptist was a man of prayer. Now, friend, thinking about it like that, if this guy who had all of those advantages, if he had to pray, how much more do we who do not have those advantages, how much more do we need to pray? And by and large, the greatest proof there is for the reality of our need to be men and women and boys and girls of prayer is the fact that Jesus was a man of prayer. As a matter of fact, what prompted this question was the disciples observing Jesus as he was alone with his Father and he was praying. Sometimes Jesus prayed all night. On those great occasions before he made great decisions like choosing his disciples, the Bible said he would spend all night in prayer. And so if there's anyone here today who says, "You know what, I really don't need to hear another sermon on prayer." Oh yeah, you do. If Jesus had to pray, how much more is it incumbent upon you and I that we be men and women of prayer? Did you notice disciples did not say, "Lord, teach us how to preach. Lord, teach us how to work miracles." They said, "Lord, teach us to pray." And I tell you, if there is any one thing that I wish that my example could create a desire in somebody else, I wish somebody could look at me like they looked at John and say, "Craig, teach me to pray." I wish I were so known for being a man of prayer that people could look at my life and they could say that of me. When we begin to look at this prayer over these 13 verses, we see that it's actually divided into three aspects. There's the vertical aspect. We will look at that today. There's the horizontal aspect. We will look at that next Sunday. Then there's the practical aspect that we will look at the following Sunday. So as we begin to think about this vertical aspect of prayer, let's talk about three things. Number one is the one we address. The one we address. So he said to them, when you pray, say, Our Father in heaven, the one we address. I think that this prayer teaches us that true prayer is born out of a spiritual relationship, a relationship that enables us to have the ability to call God our Father. You know, my children, dads, do not call you Father. Your children do not call me Father. Why? Because we don't have that relationship. But when we have a relationship with God based on our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Bible says that enables us to come to God and to address Him as our Father. And knowing the one we are addressing is everything. Back when President Lyndon Johnson was President of the United States, he had a press secretary by the name of Bill Moyers, who actually was a faithful Christian. And one day Bill Moyers was leading and saying grace over a staff luncheon, and it is said that the president said, Bill, speak up. I can't hear a thing. And Bill Moyers replied quietly, Well, Mr. President, I wasn't addressing you. Well, friends, when we are addressing God, we need to know the one we are addressing. And I really believe that one of the great weaknesses of our prayer lives and what motivates us not to be the people of prayer that we should be and that we even want to be is because of a failure to understand the one we are addressing. And I tell you, when we really get this, and this really gets a hold of us, then we are going to be motivated to be people of prayer. So the one that we address, our Father. Now let me say three things about that idea of us praying our Father. Number one is it was a revolutionary teaching. Now it's no big deal in the church today for us when we pray to say our Father. Why? We've been conditioned to pray like that. If we have been raised in church, we've been hearing people pray like that. If we were raised in a Christian home, then that's just the natural way that we approach God. And yet, I really do not believe that we fully understand what all is involved in that concept when we actually get on our knees and we say, Our Father. You see, back during the Old Testament days, they never would have prayed to God like that. I mean, in the Old Testament, they believed in the fatherhood of God, and yet that belief in the fatherhood of God was more of a belief in a sovereign creator God to whom they owed their existence. But they never talked to God and referred to Him as Father. We find that address, Father, we find it 14 times in the Old Testament. And yet every time in the Old Testament, throughout the 39 books, 14 times that it's used, it was always used from a national perspective. And speaking of God being the Father of the nation of Israel. But it was never used as an individual prayer because the Jewish people were so focused on the transcendence of God until they never would have prayed Father, which highlights the immanence of God. But when the Lord Jesus came on the scene, He completely changed that because Jesus began by talking to God as His Father. And that's the way that He taught us to pray. In fact, we read 60 times in the New Testament where Jesus addressed God as Father. In fact, the only time where Jesus prayed to God that He didn't refer to Him as Father was in Matthew 27 and verse number 46, where Jesus was dying on the cross, and there He used the name Elohim, my God, my God, my Elohim, not my Father, but my Elohim, why have you forsaken me? And of course, we know that as He was hanging on the cross, and when he prayed like that because that father-son intimate relationship had been interrupted when He who knew no sin became sin for the world. And at that point, the Bible says the Father turned his face away from the Son because they no longer had that intimate relationship in those 3 hours on the cross when Jesus Christ took upon himself our sins. But every other time when he prayed, he always addressed God as Father. And so as Jesus is teaching us to pray, he said, when you pray, pray like me. And if you pray like me, you will pray our Father in heaven. You see, it was a relationship that he wanted to get across that was not a cold and a distant relationship, but an up close and a personal relationship. And when it finally clicks with us as believers, that's the kind of relationship that we have with God. We are going to be so motivated to spend time with him in prayer. So it was a revolutionary teaching. It was also a revelational teaching. When the Lord Jesus said, our Father, the word Father there that he used was not the formal word for Father. In fact, it was a word that was used back in those days to describe how a son would address his earthly father. And the word that is used there is the word Abba. And the word that is used there that is Abba, it would be kind of like our word. And I say kind of like, I want you to put that in the back of your thinking, kind of like our use of the word Daddy. Kind of like that word. But I don't think that we can accurately, when we are addressing God in prayer, I don't think that we can refer to God as our Daddy. I don't think that we can refer to him like that because I think that that is taking a great liberty with our reverence to address him like that. And so to address God as Abba then the best translation of that would be our dearest Father. Our dearest Father. That's the idea that is being communicated. So we come to the Father in prayer and we address him as our dearest Father. And it seems to me like in the very beginning what Jesus is doing here, he's laying the very foundational principle that ought to be the foundational attitude of all of our praying, that when we approach God, we are approaching him as our dearest Father. You see, Jesus transformed the way that we view God from a distant corporate experience to an intimate one-to-one bond. It is, you might say, the language of affection. Is that the kind of attitude that you have when you come before the Father in prayer? Does this awareness fuel your prayer life, that you are approaching the one that you can refer to as my dearest Father? Friend, I want to tell you, this adds a sweetness to our souls when we realize this. It really infuses energy into our relationship when we approach the Father like this. But not only was it a revelational teaching, it was also a reflective teaching. A reflective teaching. I don't think there's any way that we can refer to God like this without sitting down and reflecting on what that actually means. And when we reflect on God as our Father, you know, it's unlike terms like omniscience and omnipotence, which almost have the feel of computer software. But when we're referring to God as our Father, it calls us into an experience of intimacy. And it reminds us of so many things and ways that we ought to think about God. It reminds us of God's goodness. For example, if you look down in verse number 9, so I say to you, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it shall be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead of a fish? Or if he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If you then, being evil, if you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit and every other good gift to those who ask him? See, when we reflect upon God as our Father, it reminds us of his goodness and his kindness and his grace and his mercy and his forgiveness and his love and his security and his peace. And when these kind of thoughts are running through our minds about the one that we are approaching, when these thoughts are running through our minds, we will be running to our prayer closets. But so many times when we have this unbiblical view of the God that we are approaching, we stay away from him in prayer rather than approaching him in prayer. And so that's point number one. But the second thing that we notice is the name we revere. The one we address, but secondly, the name we revere. If there's one thing I have learned through the years about prayer, is that prayer has to be balanced. We must use the balanced approach. Not only is there the attitude of paternity, our Father, but there's also the attitude of reverence in heaven. Our Father, but where is he? The Bible says he is in heaven. Now, a couple of things about that. Number one is the meaning of the name. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. You know, we don't think much about names today, do we? We name our children, we just simply hang a name on a child as a label for their identity. Maybe we'll name a child after someone that is in our family. They mean a lot to us, and we want to name our child after them. But that was so foreign to the concept of Jewish thinking, because every time they named a child, they named that child based on the character they wanted that child to become. And so when we read that verse there, hallowed be thy name, we need to understand when they thought about the name of God, especially, they were talking about the character of God and what that name represented. For example, Psalm 20, verse 7. Some said, some trust in horses, some in chariots, but we will trust in the name of the Lord our God. And they were saying, we will trust in the character of the Lord our God. And so for the Jew, the name of God was pointing to the reality and the nature and the character of God. But friends, put this all together. We normally don't think of it like this. When Jesus said, when we are to pray, hallowed be thy name. Which name? The name Father. Because he said, that's how we are to pray. Now, obviously, we are to hallow every name of God. We are to hallow Elohim, the omnipotent God. We are to hallow El Shaddai, the protector God. We are to hallow Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. But it seems to me like specifically Jesus is trying to say something here, that we are to hallow the name of God, that is the name Father. How do we do that? Well, I think that leads us logically to the second point, and that is the meaning of hallow. What are we talking about when we say hallow? If we are to hallow his name, Father, we got to know what hallow means. And to hallow just simply means to set apart something as being holy, to consider something holy. As a matter of fact, to make something holy, to take a biblical illustration like the utensils that were used in the tabernacle and temple, and they were referred to as holy utensils, they were holy because they functioned according to their intended purpose. So to hallow something means to set it aside that it might accomplish its intended purpose. Now what Jesus is saying is that when we pray, our Father, we are to recognize what it means for him to be Father, and that the intended purpose of that name is to accomplish something within our lives. And I think the best alternative word that we could come up for that word hallow, would be the word revere. Revere. And so, church family, this is to be our praying. Our Father, may you be given the unique reverence that your character and your nature as Father demands. May you be honored, may you be worshiped, may you be glorified because of all of the things that come out of your name as Father. For all of those attributes and characteristics that flow out of the name Father, God, may you be honored for that. May you be revered for your goodness and your kindness and your grace and your mercy and your love and your forgiveness and your protection and your provision and all of the things that we are saying when we confess you to be our Father. May you be praised for that. And may we be grieved when your name Father is not praised for that. So the question is, how in the world then do we hallow his name as Father? I think that there are two primary ways. Number one is with our lips. In John chapter 17, Jesus is praying. And Jesus says in that high priestly prayer, now listen to this, O righteous Father. So how does he approach God? Father. He says, O righteous Father, the world has not known you. Stop right there. O righteous Father, the way that I know you, that intimate relationship, the world, unsaved people, they have not known you as Father. But I have known you, and these have known that you sent me. And I have declared to them your name. What name? Father. O righteous Father, the world has not known you as Father, and I have declared them to you as Father. Should we not work and pray and do everything that we can possibly do to get the word out as to the kind of God God is? Who is he? He's Father. But friend, the unsaved world, they don't know that. The unsaved world, they don't have a clue. You realize that one great reason that the world rejects God is because they do not know they can know him in the sweetness of a relationship as a father and a child. World doesn't know that. The world's ignorant of that. And Jesus said, I've declared to them, this is the kind of relationship they can have with you. But the world sees God as man. He's out there somewhere in outer space. He doesn't care about me. He doesn't care about my life. He doesn't care about my needs. I can't know him in a personal, intimate way. He is just sitting up there with an iron fist ready to pound me. And Jesus said, it grieves my heart because that's the way the world thinks about God. So, Father, I'm doing everything I can do to convince the world they can have this sweet relationship and this sweet fellowship with you. It's known as a relationship between a father and a child. Friend, I want to tell you, there's nothing like this in the religious world. Nothing like this. Did you know that the only religion which is the true religion, which is Christianity, that's the only religion that says we can address God as Father? Islam doesn't know him like that. The Hindus, their God, they don't know him like that. And maybe today, you're genuinely born again. But you've never thought of God like this, that you can address Him as Father. So how then do we hallow His name as Father? We do it by our lips, by telling people about the kind of God that He truly is. You know, if God is rejected by the world because the world just says, I don't have anything to do with Him, that's one thing. But friend, if the world rejects God because I don't tell them what kind of God He really is, man, I don't want that on my record, do you? I want to tell people what kind of God that He truly is. And man, there's this sweet relationship that is theirs for the gaining. But when I think about not only honoring with our lips, I would say we also honor Him with our actions. With our actions. That's how we hallow that name. Since He is our Father, and since He is good, He desires good for us. What earthly father is there in this building today that would desire bad for one of your children? Not a one. So since God is good as Father, He desires good for us. He is kind and He's gracious and He's loving. He's the provider and the protector. Dads, aren't you that for your kids when they're growing up? Don't you provide for them? Don't you protect them? Of course you do. And friend, that leads me to ask this convicting question. Are we really hallowing His name as Father? Which when we confess that, we are saying, God, You're my protector and You're my provider. Are we hallowing that name as Father when we live our lives worried to death, anxious, in fear? You know the answer to that question. No, we're not. And friend, it's not just a fear about a pandemic. It's a fear about anything. Anytime I'm telling you that we are wringing our hands and we are worried to death, we are not hallowing His name as Father. Because as Father, He has promised, I'm your provider. I'm your protector. And so by our very actions, the world ought to have this appetite created within them to know this God that they see in us, that we have this unreserved trust and confidence and faith in. And while we must speak words of witness to others, I'm telling you, the world just seeing that would make a huge impact in the lives of those who do not believe in Him. So the name that we revere. But then the third thing is the desire we express. The desire we express. Down in verse number 2, here is the desire we express. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Your kingdom come, Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And remember, this is a structure of prayer that tells us the things that ought to be included within our daily prayers. And it's actually an attitude that ought to be laced throughout our praying. Do we pray with that in mind, or do we just get on our knees and say, Father, I need Your help today. I need this and this and this and this and this. Or is it more detailed? Is it more involved in that? And He says that as we are praying, we ought to be thinking about, and this ought to be our attitude, Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your kingdom come. That ought to be the desire that we are expressing. What does it mean for His kingdom to come? You know that the idea of the kingdom of God just literally means the rule and the reign of God in the hearts and lives of people. And so what we are praying for with this attitude is that God, we want you to rule and we want you to reign in your kingdom. So as we are praying like that, that tells us that it has a present aspect and a future aspect of our praying. Your kingdom come. Truth is, we cannot pray this prayer. We can mouth the words, but we cannot pray the prayer without having an intentional desire in our hearts for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. And should not we be praying, Lord, your kingdom come, your will be done. I long for the day when I, in that kingdom, I see your justice and your righteousness ruling and I see it reigning. I long for a kingdom where there are no prisons because no one ever commits a crime. I long for a kingdom where there are no hospitals because no one ever gets sick. I long for a kingdom where there are no nursing homes because no one ever grows old. I long for a kingdom where there are no cemeteries because no one ever dies. Lord, your kingdom come. Dear friend, there's a lot more to it than that. Because when we are praying, your kingdom come, your will be done, we are not praying that prayer only for the future. We're praying it for now. Are you listening? Say amen. Amen. Your kingdom come, your will be done now. If the kingdom of God means the rule and the reign in the hearts and lives of people, then what we are praying for with this prayer is that God will rule our lives right now. Right now. That's what we're praying for. We're not simply praying for the rule of God in the lives of others. We're praying for the rule of God in our own lives. And dear friend, if we are in reality not just mouthing the words but praying this prayer, what we are asking for is for God to rule over our lives right now. And friend, that prayer request has three demands. If we really pray that, we acknowledge, number one, that it demands repentance. Demands repentance. You see, this prayer is a personal thing, a very personal thing. How many of you know that our will wants to go its own way? Am I the only one in this room that possesses a will like that? I fight that one every day. Craig wants to go his own way! Exclamation point. Double exclamation point. But when we pray this prayer, your kingdom come, what we are praying is, redirect my will, God, to your will. It demands repentance. I can't pray this prayer if I'm not actively, daily repenting. And you can't either. It means that we're going to be serious about walking a lifestyle of obedience to God's word. That's what it means to pray that prayer. It demands repentance. It also demands commitment. Jesus was crystal clear in Luke 9:62 when he said, "No man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God." It demands a commitment to follow Jesus on a daily basis. But it also demands a pursuit. Demands a pursuit. You see, to pray your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven means that I'm going to be pursuing this. Matthew 6:33, Jesus said, "Seek ye first the what? Kingdom of God. Seek ye first the rule and the reign of God over your own individual life." Friend, I want God to rule and reign over your life. But I tell you, my greatest challenge is not Him ruling and reigning over your life. It's Him ruling and reigning over my life. Craig, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. If you do that, everything else you need, it's going to be added unto you. So when I am praying this prayer in the right way, then I am pursuing to align my life underneath the rule of God. My business life, my married life, my parenting life, my stewardship life, my church life. I'm seeking to align my life under the rule of God. And friend, when I realize that the one that I'm wanting to rule is my Father, who is loving and kind and gracious and forgiving and merciful, my Father, who is my provider and my protector. Friend, it's not a bad deal to submit and to surrender to that God when you know Him as Father. A few years ago, the National Football League, if the flag was not accepted, then they would lose a timeout. If it was, the play would be overturned. When the coach threw the flag on the field, what we were saying to the referees, I don't agree with that call. And when he threw the flag on the field, then the referee would stop the play and he would look at that call more intently. Sometimes he would go to the sidelines and look through the little camera so that he could see that call in detail. And a lot of times he would overturn the call. Circumstances would be completely reversed. When we pray this prayer in the right way, we're throwing a flag. God always pays attention to the flag of prayer, always, when it's prayed in the right way. And sometimes God will even reverse the circumstances of a situation as we throw that flag. And so when we come before the Lord in prayer and we have the proper attitude about this aspect, when we are really aware of this divine paternity, that God is our Father, and when we are praying with a real conviction for God as Father to be made known to others, and when we are praying with a desire for His rule and reign to be experienced in our own lives and are longing for the future coming of His kingdom, when we're praying like that, God will pay close attention to our prayers. No wonder these disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray. Teach us to pray. I think that I can safely say the greatest need in my life today and the greatest need in your life today is for the Lord to teach us to pray. Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed. And Father, what an amazing two verses of Scripture. God, how I pray that these verses would come off the pages and get into our hearts. Father, I pray that we would begin to practice what we have learned today in our prayer closet in the morning. Father, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray. Father, I pray for that person who is here today who is not a Christian, who is thinking, wow, I never considered God like this. I never considered that I could have a relationship with Him as a Father. God, I pray for that person that they would understand that that can only happen through a relationship with Jesus Christ. They must be born again. They must be saved by Your grace. And I pray that this morning they would come forward and they would tell one of our counselors, I want to be saved today. God, I pray for anyone else who is here today who simply needs to pray, to utilize this altar. I pray for those, God, that you have led to be a part of this church fellowship. You have given them spiritual gifts, and you want to use those gifts to help us to accomplish your mission for us. I pray that they would come and unite with us today. Father, may you be glorified in our invitation. In Jesus' name I pray. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed.